Hello everyone, welcome to my channel, The Lecture Notes. So today I'll be explaining a novel written by Bapsi Sidhwa, The Bride. In this particular video, I've explained from chapter 1 to chapter 4. So what I have done is, I have given you a short summary of every chapter, and I'll be giving my critical points or analysis that what I came to encounter when I read it. So starting from the plot of the novel, it is based on a real life story which was narrated to Bapsi Sidhwa by her husband Nushir, who had been invited to a remote army camp. Secondly, the Pakistani Bride hinges on the theme of marriage, honor, partition, and the struggle of women to find a space in male-dominated society. So in every chapter, you'll notice the plight of women, that how they were subjugated and marginalized by the male-dominated society. So starting from the first chapter, Mountain Life and Their Code of Conduct. Kasim was 10 years old when his father told him that he's getting married. Along with a heavy muzzle loader in his arms, he was told the decision that his father's friend did not give him loan money, so he was offering his daughter. So from the first page, you will observe that a 10-year-old boy is given a gun, and secondly, a bride. This, he has not entered the teenage period also, and he has been given the responsibility, a gun which can kill the people, and secondly, a bride be taken responsible for. So chiseled into precocity by a harsh life in the mountains, Kasim had known no childhood. From infancy, responsibility was forced upon him, and at 10, he was a man conscious of the rigorous code of honor by which his tribe lived. So clearly from the first page, you will realize that mountain life had a code of conduct that within that if a person borrows money and he is unable to pay, then he gives his daughter. So how woman or a girl child has been treated as an object, that if you can't give money or property, then you can give your daughter. And secondly, how a small boy is seen as a man who can take care of everything, while on the other hand, women were seen as something who cannot take care of themselves, who are merely an object, and they, men need to be taken care of them. Women were not a part of their life decision. You will see that Kasim was happy that he got a gun and a new playmate, while Afshan, the wife, the girl he was going to get married to, was decked up as a bride. Thrice she was asked if she could accept Kasim, the son of Arbab, as her husband, and thrice an aunt murmured yes on her behalf. So in this particular paragraph, you will see that how Afshan, a girl, was not given the basic right of making her life decision. She was not saying yes. On her behalf, her old aunt was saying yes. So clearly she was not taken apart. She was not taken part in the basic life decisions. And secondly, she could not give, she could not have the basic privilege of saying yes to her husband also. On the first night, she could not believe that a small boy was her husband. She did not know whether to cry or laugh, but eventually accepted her fate. She accepted her homely duties and only saw Kasim as a little brother to be taken care of. So I'll be giving a gist of this, of every chapter. So on the first night, she thought that her marriage is to a man because she had never seen the person she's going to get married, but instead there was a 10-year-old boy, and she kind of laughed and cried on her destiny that she was married to a small boy and not to a man, according to her. So time passed and their relationship grew, but Afshan only saw Kasim as a little boy or as a brother who she had to take care of. Kasim was 14 in his teenage when he saw his wife bathing in the river and grabbed her. With his age, he had become a man, but their relationship had not grown. So Afshan lashed out and slapped him. A nearby villager came and started beating him, but was saved by Afshan when she told the truth. So you'll see that how their relationship eventually grew. And now after this particular incident, their relationship changed and they lived as husband and wife. At the age of 16, Kasim became father, But the family could not be a happy family. Out of the four children, only one survived, Zaitoon. She'll be the major protagonist. She'll be the important person through which all the novel revolves. So Kasim and Zaitoon are important character. The wife will die eventually. So she is not the important. Afshan is not the major character. Zaitoon, apple of his eye, but she also faced a deadly disease called chickenpox, Mata, to which Kasim lost his child as well as wife. So in this particular chapter, you will know that whole family of Kasim dies. And at the age of 34, he is a single widow man living alone. So he left alone in the family. He found a job of watchman in a bank in the plains of Jalandhar. So he shifts to another place. He leaves the mountains and go to plains because now he's a lone man and he doesn't want to get married again. So he leaves that place. So this was the crux of chapter one, in which the basic point was that how Afshan was not given a chance to say yes to her marriage also, and the aunts murmured. And secondly, how Kasim was seen as a man and not a boy at the age of 10. Moving to the second chapter, Kasim stayed in Jalandhar half-heartedly, but loath to go his hometown, Kohistan, the mountains, but stayed here because of the thought that he'll be forced to remarry again. So living in mountains, you have a certain code of conduct. And to avoid that code of conduct, he half-heartedly remained in plains of Jalandhar, though he missed his homeland, that is Kohistan. The difference was greatest in the really basic values. The men of the plains appeared strangely effeminate. Women roamed the streets in brazen proximity. These people were soft. Their lives were easy. Where he came from, that is the mountains, men as in the Stone Age walked 30 days over the lonely, almost trackless mountains to secure salt for the tribes. So we'll be giving a glimpse that how mountains and plains lies are totally different. Here, men get everything on their doorstep. On the other hand, for the basic necessities, for the salts also, the mountain people have to go in search for days, and they don't have a proper road or track to find anything. So it is like a nomadic life, that for every basic necessity you have to roam around. Then it is, the earth is not easy to crave up. That is the part next Bapsi Sadeva tells about how the partition occurred and how it was dismantling a body, not carving an earth, but it was dismantling all over people. The earth is not easy to crave up. India required a deft and sensitive surgeon, but the British stepped in domestic preoccupation, hastily and carelessly butchered it. They are not deliberately mischievous, only cruelly negligent. So this is a very apt line that how partition occurred and how Britishers did not think about that, what should they do, and they haphazardly cut Hindustan into two unequal, and without any thought they did the partition. I saw them myself, huge cauldrons of boiling oil and babies tossed into them. So you'll in this chapter, Bapsi Sidhua tells that how both Sikh, Hindu, Muslims, everyone was in the mind of revenge. They did not see people as humans. They only saw them as Sikh or Muslim or enemy. So totally humanity was lost, and they were the Sikhs who were drowning small babies into large vessels of oil. And the Sikh give a reason that why he is being so insensitive is that I had a 20-year-old brother, tall and strong as a mountain. That is what they did. They tied one of his legs to one jeep and other to another jeep, and then they drove the jeeps apart. So he says that I've lost the touch of humanity because my own brother has faced such a thing. So in this particular chapter, Bapsi Sidhua tells that what exactly happened in partition and how people lost their people and the touch of humanity. So this is a random thing that Qasim saw at the time of partition. Moving on to chapter 3, Sikandar and Zora. A tongue piece, that's all. Hide the jewelry somewhere on your body. Come on, hurry up. So another piece of story at the time of partition was of Sikandar and Zora. They were a small happy family. Sikandar, Zora and Munni. That is the two husband, wife and one daughter, Munni. And in a haphazard way, they packed everything they could in a small piece of box, and they left their property, land, gold and whatever important was to them. They only could take one trunk of jewelry and that's it. Abba, the calf, there it is, cried Munni, pointing it out. Get the calf, Abba, don't leave it, she's my baby, she'll die. Her mother scolded, we haven't room for ourselves and you want to take the beast. So clearly showing that how people had lost so much, not only property, but also the people or the living things like animals they had lost to save themselves, to save only themselves. They lost their property, their beloved, their animals, everything. So on the same train, Qasim was traveling, and this train was going from Jalandhar to Lahore, and this same train was boarded by Qasim also, as well as this family. So Qasim, a roistered pistol strung across his chest, a rifle swinging down his back, walked rapidly towards the engine, scanning the compartments. Next to Qasim sat a man who was eager to settle in Pakistan with his wife, four sons and their families, all of whom are scattered about the train. He asked Qasim that why he was carrying a pistol, to which Qasim tells that to kill his enemies. And then Qasim tells he killed someone just before he boarded the train. So I'll tell you one more thing about the train, that not only the compartments were filled, the roof over the train was also filled with people. And the driver did not stop for the whole distance, because they thought that if they stopped, the Sikh would loot and kill the people. So the train moved continuously, and the people were sitting on the roof also, and nobody could go for washroom also, so thinking that they might lose their place. So whether it was children or old people, they could not urinate also, and they were doing this process while sitting on their specific places only, because they had a fear that if they step out of the train or go to washroom, they will lose their place. So here Qasim tells that he carries the gun, because he has a gun, because he was a watchman and watchman used to had a gun. So he's carrying that gun while he is traveling from Jalandhar to Lahore, and he tells that he is carrying this gun because he has killed someone before he boarded the train. So he tells the story that why he killed someone and who was that someone. Qasim had an enmity with a bank clerk, Girdhari Lal. To make a fuss, Qasim many times used to clog toilet and stones, and one day Qasim was caught red-handed. The verbal fight ended up in a physical one, and in the end, because of manager, Qasim had to apologize. But the thought of revenge, sorry, this is revenge, came in his mind. So the following night, he went to his house where Girdhari Lal used to live with his family. Qasim was like a hungry tiger kept from his victim by chains. Qasim learned from his cousin that killing, no matter what the provocation, was not acceptable by the laws of the land. He would be caught and hanged. So first of all, you will again notice the mountain rule, that if one abuses you or say anything verbal fight, you need to kill this man to establish your control. That was the mountain rule, but it did not apply to the plains rule, where his cousin tells him that if you kill him or murder him or do any harm, you will be hanged. So he had to understand the plain rules, where the code of conduct of mountains was very weird and abrupt, that it was seen as an honor to kill someone, while on the other hand, this was not an acceptable condition in the plains. And secondly, you will see that how Qasim also had an anger of revenge, that how he also sees that honor is the most important thing, and for that, he's ready to kill someone. Moving on to the next chapter, while their they were sitting on the train, that family of the three as well as Kasim, someone says his very mountain instincts warn him. In a flash, he turns to the old man shouting, jump. So someone shouted, jump, jump, and Kasim jumped. And what he sees that as soon as he jumped, within 500 or 700 meters, he saw that the Sikh had stopped the train and they were killing and looting the people. And Kasim watches the massacre as in a cinema. He was watching everything. Although he is horrified by the slaughter, he feels no compulsion to sacrifice his own life. So you'll see that he is watching, he is being an audience, but he does not try to save anyone. These are people from the plains, not his people. So clearly he is still living his mountain's code of conduct, that it is not his people, he doesn't know anybody, so he doesn't have to save anybody. All the people are strangers, the plains people, so he is not responsible to save anyone. So while he was watching it, he saw a small girl clutching to his legs. The small girl is Munni, that I have told in chapter 3, that family of three were traveling together, and the small girl crying for her calf, Munni, is the small girl referred here. Kasim drew her to him. What is your name? Munni. Just Munni. Aren't all little girls called Munni? Just Munni. You must have another name. Do you know your father's name? My father's name was Sikandar. Her use of the past tense startled him, that how she used was instead of is. Munni, you are like a smooth dark olive, the Zaitun, that grows near our hills. The name suits you. I shall call you Zaitun. So this is the Zaitun was the name of Kasim's dead daughter, which he gave to Munni. And now you will see that throughout the novel, now her identity is changed from Munni to Zaitun. And secondly, how he is astonished that how can your name be just Munni, that how common names shows that how their identity did not matter, and their identity only is fixed with their father or husband. Secondly, the thing to be noticed is that how he ask what is your father's name, he does not ask what is your mother name. And you will see in chapter 5 or 6 also that he does not ask what is your mother name, that how father name is only important, and how father names gives you an identity, while the role of the mother is only to give birth and take care of you. You are only known by your father or your family name. So how women plays no role in the terms of identity. So thank you for watching this.